Say, Dad, when you're out there, did you see anything?
Let's not start that flying saucer nonsense again.
Hey, Dad.
Now, what do you want?
What happened to your net? It looks like there's a...
Nothing. I caught it on a barbed wire fence.
Barbed wire? But there isn't any barbed wire between...
I caught it on barbed wire, I said! Now, you get your clothes on.
Yes, David, hurry and get dressed. I want you to do some errands. I'm sorry that
I... Your husband?
Yes, I'm George McLean. I'm sorry my wife put you to so much trouble.
Think nothing of it.
You feel all right?
Yes, I'm fine.
Well, then we won't report this.
We'll forget the entire matter, won't we, Mary?
Yes. Won't you have some coffee?
Don't be silly, Mary. These gentlemen have some important work to do.
Yeah, you too.
Yes, I know.
We'll see you around.
What are you gaping at?
What were those men talking about? As though you were in some kind of a plot together.
Don't talk nonsense, Mary. Thought I told you to get dressed.
Hello and welcome to Still Watching the Skies for September 2021. I'm Robert Reinecke.
I'm Nat Elmorel.
I'm Cody Lane.
Every month we explore the lesser discussed science fiction movies of the past. Some famous, some obscure, all of which we believe will create interesting conversations. This month we're joined by Jim Laczkowski of Voices and Visions and Directors Club to discuss a notable science fiction film from the 1950s and its remake from the 1980s, Invaders from Mars. Welcome, Jim.
Oh my gosh, I'm back, and it's great to be back. It's a blessing and a joy. Thankfully, you didn't introduce me as a huge, ugly, slimy Mr. Potato Head.
We wouldn't do that, Jim.
Oh, good. I do
we
feel like I
that
do...
after our guest has appeared on the podcast.
Yeah, I often feel like an alien sometimes. You know, like, am I really from Earth? I don't know. But no, we're going to have a lot of fun. You know, I think my favorite subgenre of movies in general is anything that involves like manipulation or mind control or just the idea of someone changing in very disturbing ways. So, yeah, you had me on for Body Snatchers, so it makes sense.
And we had you on for Dreamscape, too.
Oh, yeah.
And The Rapture.
Yes. Which I did a running commentary for, which I don't know if anyone will ever hear.
We have the OG JL on TR.
Not bad.
Well, anyhow, we got two movies, so let's get the show on the road here. First up is 1953's Invaders from Mars. I'll give a short synopsis, some key personnel, and then I'll turn it over for a discussion. David McLean is a young son of a rocket scientist. After a night of stargazing, David is awoken by a thunderstorm and thinks he witnesses a flying saucer land in the sand field behind the house. After assuring David that he's been dreaming, David's father investigates in the morning and seemingly disappears. When David's father returns, he has a weird mark on his neck and is uncharacteristically irritable. And the policeman that came to investigate seemed to be in on it too. Soon it's up to David and a friendly nurse to head off what seems to be an alien invasion. Invaders from Mars is directed by William Cameron Menzies. The screenplay is by Richard Blake, based on a story by John Tucker Battle. The cinematography is by John F. Seitz. The principal cast includes Jimmy Hunt as David McLean, Arthur Franz as Dr. Stuart Kelston, Helena Carter as Dr. Patricia Blake. I think I said Nurse Patricia Blake, but it'd be that as it may. Leif Erikson as George McLean. Hilary Brooke as Mary McLean. Morris Ankrum as Colonel Fielding. Luce Potter plays the Martian intelligence. And there's a bit part by Barbara Billingsley as Kelston's secretary. So, anybody want to jump on this first?
Let's give it to our guest.
Jim!
Gee whiz!
We've gone full circle, Jim.
Yeah, that's true. The actor's name is Jimmy.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
And Laskowski means the hunt in Polish.
I don't know if that's true.
That is absolutely not true.
Okay. Yeah, well, okay. I'm coming at this from a weird place because my first exposure to this, to these films was seeing the 1986 version opening night with my dad. And I have a special bias and a special place in my heart for that film, which we'll get to. But going back to this one, I think they're very similar in their kind of like fever dream qualities. But obviously, 50s was a very different time than the 80s. And I appreciate this version quite a bit. I enjoy it. I think it's good. I wouldn't say it's perfect. It's far from perfect. But it is like it's a... like the manifestation of a childhood nightmare where all the adults become these frightening enemies, you know, even your own parents. And yet there's like this wish fulfillment to save the world at going on at the same time, which kind of ties in thematically to why the military is so lovingly portrayed in both versions, really. But yeah, I think the production design is really top notch. Like the minimalist set at the police station is kind of creepy. And really like to this day I go, "Wow, that's there's not a whole lot there." And really sort of complements this idea of this coming from David's perspective in general. You know, Jimmy Hunt here again with the gee whiz acting. Kind of grates a little bit more. I mean, some people do say that about, you know, the 1986 is David, but I don't agree necessarily. I actually like him. But, yeah, there's some exposition-heavy dialogue from the astronomer friend. But, you know, it manages to retain a lot of its charm and creepiness at times. I think the, you know, Leif Erikson early on as the father is kind of shockingly abusive, especially at one point for that time period. It's still jarring. It's still like, ouch. But yeah, like I think it's interesting that once the father changes, he's speaking at his son, not to him, like not even looking him in the eyes the whole time. So I find that creepy. But I, you know, again, like some, I don't know if it's intentionally amusing for when the cop gets sucked into the sand early on. He almost looks like he slipped on a banana peel when he's getting sucked down into the sand. So I mean, I find certain elements of the remake a little scarier given that director. But you know, this has some really good visuals. You know, even once we get to the spaceship, even if it's just a bunch of green dudes in suits, I don't know. I'm on board for the majority of it, except maybe that running montage towards the end as David is running away goes on forever, man. I'm like, good Lord, how far is this kid running?
The only thing that the entire movie seeming like it's going on forever is the countdown.
Yeah.
Is going on for an even longer forever than that montage.
Yeah. No, I mean, I enjoy it. Again, it's like a, you know, an Outer Limits, Twilight Zone feeling stretch to, you know, 80 minutes or whatever. But, you know, it's a good time. I wouldn't say it's high art by any stretch of the imagination, but I like this era of science fiction. Again, similar to, you know, the original Body Snatchers. It has elements from that, and so this is just kind of right up my alley, even if I don't feel as much of a personal connection that I do for the other one that we'll get to.
Well, this is what, 3 years before Invasion of the Body Snatchers, I think it's probably proper to say that Invasion of the Body Snatchers has elements of Invaders from Mars.
Ooh! Wow!
How about you, Cody?
Yeah, I hadn't seen it before. I had seen the other one a few times. I thought it was good. I really liked the end montage. I do like it for how similar it is to Invasions of the Body Snatchers. It is a really 50s Cold War type of film, like where like as soon as he loses his parents, he gets like a surrogate other family already, and it seems mm-hmm. like that's the most like terrifying thing for like the American middle class, is to have like, you know, their way of life and culture being infiltrated by communists, you know, aliens and stuff. To be honest, like, I'm having a hard time distinguishing the films.
Which is fair.
Makes sense.
Plot is very similar.
Yeah, it's good. I'm really curious why Tobe Hooper wanted to remake it. Like I really like Tobe Hooper, and I like most of his movies, and I'm curious why he had, you know, like, he hasn't made that many films, so I'm curious why, like, he would pick this, but it's, like, I would say, like, the original is good. It's, there's just certain things I really think make it, like, make the remake really interesting, but, yeah, I think the ending sequence where he's running and you have all these dissolves, that was a pretty interesting part. Even though it goes on for a long time, I thought that was a really unique way to do something, especially for this time period. Overall, it's good. I liked it more than some of the other 50s ones that we've seen, for sure.
For the record, Tobe Hooper was born in 1943. It's like he's been 10 when this came out.
I'm sure he loved this when he first saw it.
Or was terrified from it and loved it.
Mm-hmm.
How about you, Nat?
Yeah, I like this quite a bit. I like the perspective. I think it's a pretty novel approach, taking it from a kid's point of view. And I think that this is something that probably inspired a lot of people, and obviously we have Tobe Hooper on deck, but I'd say I could easily see Spielberg coming back to this when he's doing E.T. Or like potentially Lucas, and I think the dream aspect of it is, like, you can always say that's kind of a cop-out, but I feel that it really makes as much use of it as it can in this, in terms of like getting rid of the parents very quickly, and even like killing a little girl, and I think that the production design, it's jarring when you first see it, but kind of reading more about the director, who was a pretty big name in production design, like working on Gone with the Wind and having quite a big sway in that, like, it does kind of call it out. And the police station is the one where it's so minimalist, where it's like you just have the lights and a desk, and then eventually a jail cell, that it kind of stands out. And I think also just the image of the fence and where the aliens are, where the alien ship ultimately lands, like, that's a weird-looking location. And the fence itself, I think, is just very, very prominent right over the horizon. And, you know, that's also an image that basically is just directly lifted in the remake as well. So there's something kind of jarring about that. And I think even the article that you sent, Robert, said that it has kind of like a expressionistic kind of look to it, which, yeah, I can see that. But I think, like, going back over the movie, and I'd like to rewatch it, I'm guessing that there may be some cues to that in terms of, like, this is how a child would see this sort of thing. Like, they probably haven't been to a police station, and so they are not quite sure what it looks like, but you know what jail looks like, and you know what a police officer looks like, and so you kind of fill in the blanks there. And then the same thing for, like, the fence. It's that creepy place behind your house. And even though whenever they go to town, there's a lot of houses or buildings in town, like, there's nothing. There seems to be just, like, this weird wilderness, like, on the edge of existence from right behind the house. Like, it becomes a desert, effectively, like, right behind his house. And I can see that as, like, how a child would perceive kind of this weird area that they kind of grow up looking out of. And maybe that's all bullshit, but I can't imagine that somebody who is an actual production designer, you know, like, showing that much restraint when it comes to actual production design. But I think it also gets into some pretty neat ideas as well. Like, you know, I think every time that we're looking at any sort of mind control movies from the 50s, we immediately think communism. But it does some neat things in here where I think at one point they say that it's actually more of a defensive move on the part of the Martians because of, like, Earth rockets. And that's an interesting sort of perspective there. And then they layer it by essentially having, like, them kill off a lot of people and implant these things so you can kind of feel nasty about them. And then the narrative kind of just goes away in, like, the last half hour of the film when they storm the compound. But I don't know if it all adds up to something that's, like, extremely good or even a great movie, but I feel like it has a lot of moments where it takes some interesting turns or just has, like, a throwaway scene that adds a new perspective or some neat new idea. And I think, too, this is one that probably gets in a little bit more in terms of, like, trying to explain some of the science. I like them going to the observatory and actually looking at it from an observatory, which is, like, that, why wouldn't you do that? And I kind of wish they'd done something like that in the remake as well. But I like, too, that David is not your typical youngster. He's, like, a little bit more objective. Like, yeah, he has high emotions, but he tries to be a little bit more rational. And I think that's fair to say that there's kind of a reading of this being, like, a story of, like, a kid growing into maturity, where, like, as you're a kid, you know, you see your parents in a certain perspective, but then as you grow older or kind of, like, go through, say, teenage years, you become interested in different things, and cue, like, sexy Dr. Blake or Nurse Blake or whatever, who's, like, immediately following him around and who's not so much like a mother figure, but like the sort of female companion in that. And I just think that this goes beyond, like, something that's just a simple, like, B movie or drive-in fare, and actually has some pretty neat ideas in it. And I'll also say, too, I love the personality of his parents, and I really like that in the remake as well. And I also like, I think the actual aliens or the Martians, or at least the Martian intelligence, is very effective and more effective in this film than the remake. I like the effect of, like, the eyes turning red and then becoming, like, realize. But I was very impressed by it, and it's a smooth 77 minutes or so. And just reading some of the reviews of it at the time, like, they said it's, you know, if this is absolutely not appropriate for kids, like, they'll be terrified of it.
Wow. Well, there are condoms in this movie, so.
Yes, and also mutants.
Mutants.
But no, I was pretty impressed by it.
I was pretty impressed by it too. Maybe not with all the stock army footage, but I understand why all the army footage is in here, but I feel that it's one that it works on two levels. I mean, one's definitely aimed at kids, and there's a level that's aimed at adults, and I think they both kind of work together. I mean, I feel that the production design, I think, is very well done. I'll refer to reading the review in Keep Watching the Skies by Bill Warren, and he referred to it that the house where Jimmy lives is very realistic and detailed, but the farther he gets away from the house, the more it becomes expressionistic and vague. And I think that's a very smart way to do it, and it's very exaggerated vertically, at least especially the police station, with those doors that seem like 10 feet high, if not higher.
I didn't notice that. Yeah.
Okay. And there's a lot of shots that are shot from a low level, further exaggerating the height. So I feel that's it's well directed from that point of view, and I think it's rather interesting. And certainly the things like the kind of whirlpools of sand, I think, is an interesting effect, which I think works really well. And there's a lot of other little subtle things in there. I noticed that when the mother is possessed and comes to the police station, she's wearing black, in contrast to the nurse doctor, who's wearing white with that kind of little red badge on it. I feel that they kind of get the child's nightmare logic corrected there, or at least it seems a good approximation, and I like all of that. And I feel that it's the way that all the adult authority figures get taken over. That must have been especially nightmare fuel for kids in the 50s, especially when the adults get taken over. I mean, I think it's a good observation that he does form another surrogate family later, but it is certainly that, and he's certainly worried about them being killed off in it. And I feel that as a dream, Jimmy has a rather high opinion of himself, or David McLean has a rather high opinion of himself, because all the adults will ultimately listen to him, and he is basically the hero.
Well, they all say he's very rational. I'm like, yes. Oh, yeah.
Oh, nothing but compliments for him.
Yeah.
And I feel that the army men is especially important in the 1950s with the tanks and all that. And it's almost a literal sandbox with that sand pit out back that they're playing around with and blowing things up in. So again, I feel that they know exactly what type of movement they're making there. So I'm on board with all that. I don't really like Jimmy Hunt all that much, though. But I don't like many child actors of that era either. And everything he says is it at like a 110%. And there's no realism or subtlety to it. And I feel that movies have gotten a lot better at kid actors. This one I find a little bit grating at times. And I don't know if there's a standout performance in here other than that, though I do like Leif Erikson as David's dad. I feel that he goes from charming to creepy. He managed that transition very well. And also, I do like Helena Carter, and I like Hilary Brooke as the mother, too. So I feel all of them are doing a good job. So I like the alien intelligence production design. So anything else we want to get into here?
I will say I don't mind Jimmy Hunt. I actually do like him a lot better. I think the performance is a lot better than the remake. But we can get into that.
I do feel that the stock footage seems very repetitive there, especially them just kind of firing at the field. They should have some more angles on that, and I understand stock footage is cheap, which is why you see a lot of it in the cheap movies, but I feel that they could have done better with that. I would say that's the longest montage of them loading up the equipment and taking it to that sand field there that I get most annoyed with.
Yeah, and the very end for both films, really, I'd say that idea really kind of creeps me out, the idea of this time loop recurring nightmare scenario, just like, every time I go back to sleep, I'm going to have this horrible dream. Like, that idea kind of freaks me out. So, you know, in the original, it's just him going, oh, no, gee whiz, not again. So it's a little more silly, but...
Yeah.
I don't know. I do like the idea of the ending, even though people are just quick to go, oh, it was all a dream. How lame. Nowadays, we would hate that twist, you know?
We might, but... I feel this one plays fair with us. I do think the best one that's pulled off the All a Dream one is Dead of Night, the 1940s British horror anthology.
Mm.
But that one kind of worked because it's just so hopeless.
Yeah.
Man, I feel like the dream thing here, it feels more like a way to get around probably some censors. So, or at least, like, you know, people who would accuse it of, like, some moral turpitude, like, of just kind of offing the parents immediately, or offing, like, a little girl, or having her taken over by it, or having, like, a, you know, him team up with, like, a sexy nurse / physician. But I feel it's something where it's, like, it's designed more to give them, like, some structural leeway in it. Mm-hmm. And, like, if they could have at the time, you know, potentially would have kept it kind of that way, or, like, kept that ending without the dream sequence. But I do feel it's something that, like, is just giving them, you know, some freedom to mm-hmm. be a little bit more bleak than they otherwise probably, you know, either the studio would have wanted or censors or whatever.
Yeah. Speaking of that little girl, I thought her performance was quite good, though.
And with that, we can jump to the remake.
We sure can.
Okay. I'm gonna play a clip from the remake, and then I will give another short synopsis and key personnel.
I understand how it must sound, General. But I can assure you, it's absolutely true.
I don't know. People being sucked under the sand. A lot of aliens running around loose underneath the town. That's a little hard to swallow.
Excuse me, sir. NASA does confirm a visual sighting. A UFO. 2 nights ago during the meteor shower, but radar reported no strike. In fact, sir, radar reported nothing at all.
General, what if the ship absorbed energy? It wouldn't show up on radar because no one drew a bounce back, right?
Sir, search teams were sent out to look for signs of impact or landing. The 2 men who checked out the Copper Hill area gave it a clean report.
That's because they were sucked out of the sand. They're all part of it.
Walker, would you please come in here? Ma'am, I'd like you and the boy to leave us for a moment.
Yes, sir.
Sir?
Walker, I want you to escort these 2 people to the briefing room.
Yes, sir. Please follow me.
I want you to notify NASA that we're going to do just a routine security check on their men. I don't want to make an issue out of this.
Yes, sir.
Okay, for the 1986 remake, David Gardner is a young son of a NASA scientist. After a night of stargazing, David is awoken by a thunderstorm and thinks he witnesses a flying saucer land in the sand field behind the house. After assuring David that he's been dreaming, David's father investigates in the morning and seemingly disappears. When David's father returns, he has a weird mark at his neck and is uncharacteristically irritable. Soon it's up to David and a friendly school nerf to head off what seems to be an alien invasion. If only David can avoid his awful teacher, Mrs. McKelch. Invaders from Mars is directed by Toby Hooper. Screenplay is by Dan O'Bannon and Don Jacoby. Cinematography is by Daniel Pearl. Big technical guys John Dykstra and Stan Winston did some work on this film. The cast includes Hunter Carson, who is the son of Karen Black, as David Gardner. Timothy Bottoms as George Gardner. Lorraine Newman as Ellen Gardner. Karen Black is the school nurse Linda Magnuson. James Karen is General Clement Wilson. Bud Cort as Mark Weinstein. Louise Fletcher as Mrs. McKelch. And Jimmy Hunt as the police chief. It cost $7 million, but made only $4.9 million. So, was not a hit, but I think it is kind of at least remembered as a cult film today. Jim, I know you have a lot of strong opinions on this one, and I know this is why we are having this podcast, so why don't you start us off on this one again?
Oh, boy! you know, and when people cite this as a bad film, I'm not necessarily going to argue or defend it like some movies, because I get it. I understand if you find it silly or if you think Hunter Carson's annoying or any number of critiques you might have. Because tonally, it is kind of messy and it's like this bizarre mix of camp and dread and silliness and paranoia. It's kind of a bumper car in that way where it's like, oh, this is creepy. Oh, this is silly. Or, you know, and at the same time, this was around the era of me getting into adventure stories where the kid takes control and actually has to man up and do things. You know, similarly, a year prior, I saw The Goonies, and then a year later, I saw The Gate, the horror film The Gate. And it's in between those two. My dad and I went to this on opening night in a mostly empty theater. I don't think people were geared up and excited for this. And that opening scene with the father and son watching the meteor shower was so much like me and my dad, it was kind of scary. And I always bring this, I think I've brought this up before, but the one thing that my dad found absolutely hilarious, and he was the only one who laughed, was the moment where he returned suddenly with a friend named Ed. And my dad's best friend was named Ed, and he worked for the phone company, and he worked for the switching division. So I don't know what I was like. I did at the time as a kid, I was like, why is my dad finding that so funny? And then of course he explained it, and I was like, oh my god, that is so weird. It's just so weird that came up in this movie. But you know, Dan O'Bannon, He's responsible for, like, Return of the Living Dead, which also had James Karen. I think he's great as General Wilson. I always enjoy his presence in this. It's clear that at the time, Toby Hooper was struggling because the film that he first made for Golden Globus and Canon Films, right, was Life Force, and that was an expensive bomb, and he was under a lot of pressure to deliver a hit. So he was basically making this and the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 sequel kind of around the same time, practically. And if you watch Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, some of the sets almost look like the tunnels from Invaders from Mars. So I don't know if they were sort of like, yeah, just working on everything all at once or what the deal was. And Stan Winston was also working on Aliens at the time. And the visual effects for that. So I think the visual effects here are really effective. I actually really like the parents. You know, Timothy Bottoms is again, I think Leif Erikson does a better job at playing menace than Timothy Bottoms does. I think he's more silly in this, and you know, I kind of like that at the same time. It's interesting that Karen Black was Hunter Carson's mother, and in this, it's like she's kind of playing the lust figure in a way, I guess, kind of.
Yeah.
A little bit. A little weird.
A little Oedipus doesn't hurt anybody.
No, I guess not. I mean, I have a fondness for this era, you know, this, like, something. I'm surprised Dante didn't make this movie, to be honest. I think he might even been better suited for that blend of comedy and horror, and also he grew up on movies like this, too. But I'm happy that Toby Hooper, who made something like Poltergeist, or apparently maybe he made it, but... Yeah, I don't necessarily think Karen Black is that great. She has a really terrible screaming moment in the basement of the school when that phallic-like drill starts. I don't even know what the deal is with that thing. I guess they were drilling more tunnels and wanted one that was directly connected to the school. Like, there are logical things in here that I don't always understand, but again, like, when you know it's a fever dream scenario, I'm willing to forgive plausibility, and certainly I think Louise Fletcher is having a great time saying the words David Gardner over and over again. I really just enjoy this movie. I mean, I understand if people have a lot of criticisms, it's hard for me to be objective, because again, it was one of those that my dad and I kind of quoted sometimes to each other randomly, or when it was on cable, we'd sit back and enjoy it. I do like the creepy Martian intelligence being a giant brain of sorts. I like the little potato head creatures, and everything else that sort of plays out is very entertaining. So I think I like this one just a tad bit more than the original, probably because of the nostalgia factor again. But it's a lot of fun. That's all I can say. It's not high art. I wouldn't put on a list of great all-time science fiction movies or anything, but I really enjoy so much about it, regardless.
How about you, Cody?
I really like this one. I think it's... I don't know what Jim's talking about with people criticizing it, but I don't know why you would criticize it.
I know a lot of people who do.
I don't know. I don't see anything wrong with it. I think it's really good. I really like the creature designs. Mm-hmm. I think the brain alien is great. I like how early it shows up in the film. Like, you don't have to wait for it until the very end. I think it has lots of great scenes, like when he catches his teacher eating the toad. That's a really, really good scene. It's really effective, and I don't know. I don't see any. Like, I don't really get why there would be any criticism, although I haven't read any, so maybe there really isn't recent criticism, but...
I think a lot of people found it too campy or something, you know, and that maybe, I don't know, it's again, from a child's perspective, I sort of look at it differently, but...
I guess. I really have no problem with camp, so I guess maybe that's why. Like, it just might be a taste for myself. Like, I prefer camp to... you know, sincere stuff, I guess. And I do find it sincere, though. I don't find it too... I don't find it tongue-in-cheek. I don't know. Yeah, I just think it's really, really fun. I would include it in, you know, as good as the other 80s remakes, like The Fly and The Thing and The Blob. Ooh. Of, like, 1950s films, right? Like, I think it's really good. I think it's one of... I think when you watch this, like, you can, it's kind of more evidence that Toby Hooper did actually direct large amounts of Poltergeist.
Yeah, there's certainly Poltergeist touches in here.
House. I never really fully bought that he didn't direct it. And, you know, I feel like this is really similar to that. I think Poltergeist is a better movie, but, you know, this is really fun. And the kid's not that annoying. Like, I don't know. Like, like the kid in Time Bandits is more annoying.
That's hitting the bar a little low there, Cody.
Yeah.
But you, Nat.
So, I'm sorry, Jim. I just was not really a fan of this one. And I was gonna say too. I really like the '80s remakes of like '50s properties. I love the remake of The Blob. I really like the remake of The Fly, and even when they did like the '80s remakes of like '30s movies, or their take on it, like Fright Night and Reanimator. Just I really like horror from the '80s, but I don't know, this one didn't really resonate with me. I think when it came to the aliens themselves, and that's where it just is like, it just kind of looks ridiculous to me, and I don't quite get the camp, and I like camp quite a bit, and maybe it's just like such a weird tonal shift, where I like the domestic scenes, so I love his dynamic with his parents, I love, I think they really capture like how like the dad's not really that stern. He's like kind of, you know, a partner in crime or joking around with his son. I really, really like that. And just like how he gets along with, you know, his mother and the dynamic he has with his mother. I really like that that's kind of revamped or you know, updated with this. I like the idea of basically, you know, having like the bad guy be, you know, like a single person rather than kind of a group of people. And I think Louise Fletcher is doing a really good job there. So basically, I think, yeah, my biggest things are just kind of like where they go underground is where I just like kind of lose interest in it. And for that, like, I don't know, I can take it kind of seriously or enjoy kind of for what it is up to that point. But I also just don't really like Hunter Carson. And I just feel like some of his readings are just like pretty ridiculous. I have one of my notes of him like saying, "You don't understand." Like, and I forget where that is, but I think it's like after, you know, like, somebody's been murdered or something like that, where it seems like a really low-key reading for a horrific event. I don't know. I also wonder, too, like, yeah, this is coming off of Life Force, and I think this was released before Texas Chainsaw Massacre, too.
And, yeah, just by, like, a couple months or something, I think.
Yeah, and I feel like this is kind of his sort of studio film, and the one that he's really interested in is Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, where that just is such a weird divergence from the original and from so many things, and he just kind of goes like batshit insane from that. So I feel like this is the one he kind of made to so that he could make that one, but. Yeah, I have some issues with the kid. I like, again, the domestic scenes. There's a lot of things that are taken, I think, directly from the original, and just even like how the sand pit kind of works, or just the idea of like the sand pit itself, the fence itself, and just that look of it. And I do love the poster for this movie, but even like the coloring of Invaders from Mars, as well, and yeah, just a lot of beats that are like very specific to the original are kind of like taken directly from here. And I don't know, I think I was waiting for it to go to kind of a next level that I feel the original did, or play around or have some fun with some of the ideas. And this one just kind of seemed a little bit too straightforward or not as ambitious as I would hope from Tobe Hooper.
Well, he was on a lot of cocaine at this time.
Were we all, though?
He has a cocaine trilogy, Life Force, this, and Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2. Maybe campy is the wrong word. It's more like a cartoon. Like, a lot of people kind of cite this as being almost too silly and not creepy and scary enough. I think the tones mesh pretty well for me. And Hunter Carson does play, like the crazy wide-eyed kid to a degree that I find pretty believable, even if some points it's clear that he's going through puberty because his voice cracks while delivering certain lines. But I don't know. Especially once you get to the inclusion of James Caron, you know, it's a blast.
Well, I really like James Caron, and I agree that he kind of nails the tone that the film is looking for and the film needs, and I feel that he's the anchor. I would say that I'm not crazy about it. I feel that it's due strictly to tonal issues. Because I don't really have any problem with how it's updated, or the characters are probably fleshed out a little more. I'm not crazy about Hunter Carson, but
boom.
He's fine, I guess. But I mean, my platonic ideal of what I would like this film to be, and which is not, would be something along the lines of Phantasm. Another It's All a Dream film. Where is it?
Ooh, yeah, I would love to see a Don Coscarelli version of this. That'd be kind of cool.
So it's kind of a, this one I feel it's some parts I feel are very effective, and it's kind of a more cartoony version, and then it kind of shifts to serious. I don't think the more serious stuff works all that well. But I feel that the more comedic stuff works, although I feel that some of it is awfully broad. While I think James Caron in particular, and maybe a little bit of Bud Cort, are a little bit more precise in their comedy, and Louis Fletcher too. I feel that they're all kind of precise. The other stuff I feel is more broad, or at least they're doing different things, which is not necessarily a bad thing, but it's there. I mean, it doesn't have the exaggerated expressionistic look of the 53 version, but I do notice that there are a lot of camera angles that are from a lower angle than normal, so I feel that it's at least trying to incorporate that into it. Obviously the special effects and the are much better. I don't know if the creature design is better. I mean, the mutants are better, but the supreme the intelligence is there's some pluses and minuses to it. It's certainly more cartoony version.
Yeah, he looks like something out of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles or something.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Exactly.
Yeah, it could be Krang. But I mean, I feel it's at least trying. But I would agree that I don't think his heart is fully into it, so Toby Hooper's heart is fully into it. I mean, maybe it's just a better lead performance would have brought everything together. And I think Hunter Carson is fine, but I feel that when you build a film around a kid performance, it's always a dicey proposition.
All right, okay. Now let's do a test here. Now, is Hunter Carson more annoying in this, or the kid from Last Action Hero?
Last Action Hero.
Last Action Hero.
Okay, good. We agree. Yeah.
I take the Jimmy Hunt over the Carson Hunt any day of the week, though.
You like the G-Wiz, huh?
I like the G-Wiz because I feel like that at least is more in line with kind of what I would expect from the 1950s and the performances that everyone around him is giving. Whereas, like, you know, this Hunter Carson cannot go toe-to-toe with Louise Fletcher. And, like, she's going over the top. She's awesome at playing a bitch. And it just, like, I think she goes hard in creating this perceived threat, and I just don't see that reaction from Hunter Carson. And I think it diminishes, like, what Louise Fletcher is doing with her performance. And I think that's also, like, the best idea of this film, is, like, not just making it a teacher, but, like, a teacher where you don't know if she's actually, like, been taken over by Martians, or if she's just always been a horrible person. Like,
or she's always been Nurse Ratched.
Yeah. But that's a cool idea where, like, you know, yeah. What is it in her past that has made her such a horrible person? And for, like, a kid, you can say, oh, there can be, like, you know, a school rumor or something, like she was taken over by aliens or something like that. Or, like, you know, everybody's had that teacher, like, in that grade where they've been there forever. They've always been that same age, and they've always just been nasty. And I like that. I like that updating to that. And, yeah, the frog scene gets me, too. But just... Hunter Carson's delivery is just, like, so flat for everything, or, you know, at worst, it's just way off emotionally that I think it really does bring the movie down pretty substantially.
Boo! Well, okay, that's... Yeah, I think... Is it my love of Paris, Texas? I don't know. Because he's the kid in Paris, Texas.
And he's a great actor.
Yeah, there we go. Cody and I are going to start the Hunter Carson podcast.
We'll just
talk about this film every week.
I will pretty much. Paris, Texas. I'm saying his performance in this movie ain't good to me.
And that might be Toby Hooper's issue. I don't know how good Toby Hooper ever was with actors. I mean, Texas Chainsaw Massacre... is a horror classic. I don't know if it's because of the acting, though.
You just pulled the ripcord like Dennis Hopper, and he just goes. Like, that's, yeah. You don't need to direct Dennis Hopper.
But, yeah. I also wondered if the Martian voice that Lorraine Newman does towards the end of the film is a nice tip of the hat to her playing a conehead.
I would think so.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, there's a little inside joke for all you early SNL fans.
Actually, speaking of inside jokes, isn't his mom watching Life Force at some point
in the movie? I think so. I think he turns on the TV. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's playing.
In the middle of the afternoon.
Yeah. I also get
no Melinda Bay show about it, so.
Yeah. I also feel like Toby Hooper is kind of like trying to do a Spielberg here, like trying to do his version on E.T., or at least like this is a formula that can be massively successful. Like, let's do it from the kid's perspective and not quite nailing it.
Yeah, I honestly think that it's people can make that argument that he doesn't nail it. And even just the very end of this movie being like really scary and creepy, and then you cut to the credits and suddenly it's just like Spielberg, like peaceful score playing, you know, it's like, there you go. There's a little bit of a tonal mishmash that you can certainly argue is not being good. And yet I somehow find it all engaging and charming. And maybe it's because my impressionable brain, my 8-year-old brain seeing this movie has caused me to not recognize its flaws in any way. I just think it's a lot of fun. Little pulpy sci-fi, little cartoon, little Bud Cort. Come on.
I do like the Bud Cort sequence with the potato monsters.
They do understand me. I think if you quizzed me on this movie, I'd probably get an A. Like, if there's an Invaders from Mars quiz out there.
Now, Jim.
I do like the addition of them getting copper to power their weapons, too.
Yeah.
I think that's a nice little addition to it, along with a teacher being one of the main characters of the film. So I think those are nice updates.
I got two things, one for Jim, one for Robert. So, Jim... Or I guess this is open for discussion for anyone. Even though it's the 1980s, like, if you cut yourself on a scalpel in class, would your biology teacher, like, curse you out and get super pissed at you? Or they freak out and be like, shit, you gotta get to the nurse's office. Like, she seems, like,
isn't she an alien at that point? Or, you know, isn't she converted or whatever?
Yeah, but nobody else seems to mind. Like, this seems to be a pretty common occurrence where it's just like, man, fucking McKeach is just, like, going off on poor little Davy Gardner, he cut his whole hand open with a scalpel, and she just berated him for like 20 minutes.
That's true.
You think she'd be worried about getting sued?
Yeah.
This silly boy has cut himself.
Yeah. Now, I will also nitpick in the original where, like, the kid gets thrown in prison or in jail, like,
oh, that's true.
For like, misbehaving, and his mom, like, when she comes to pick him up, like, the kid's just saying stuff, and she's like, he's totally out of control. Like, okay, it's the 50s. I can kind of get that, but still seems a little ridiculous, but not quite as ridiculous as a kid cutting his hand open with a scalpel and then just, yeah, getting berated by his teacher. But I don't know, that seemed really weird, and all the other kids, like, I guess they deserve to die if they, they're just so nonplussed by this happening.
I did find it be a good joke that paid off when the bus shows up at the sand pit, though.
What's the joke?
When all the kids show up at the sand pit.
Oh.
Yeah, because they're all going to get turned.
Yeah.
Ah, yes.
And he doesn't like any of them, apparently. Doesn't have any friends at school.
Well, I can't blame him. With a cool dad like that, I mean, do you need any other friends?
You gotta love the silhouette of Heather standing in the nurse's doorway with her pigtails.
Yes.
That's a good image.
That is good. That's a nice little visual cue or visual gag there. Okay, now Rob,
I can say my teachers were not like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Yeah, I'm pretty sure mine would have freaked out. Jim?
Oh, yeah. No, my teachers were very nice overall. They would have been very concerned and sent me to the nurse's office and not berate me for cutting myself, that's for sure.
Cody?
Yeah, they were nice.
Okay. Let's see. Well,
how about you as a teacher, Cody?
Well, people don't usually cut themselves in university.
I was going to, well...
No, what, did they say something stupid in class to deserve berration?
Well, it doesn't matter. They don't even care enough to talk, so...
I would probably be more concerned, like, why the hell would a student bring a scalpel to a film class?
Yeah, they don't even attend the class. It doesn't even... So it's not even... Yeah, it doesn't even get to that point.
I'm sorry, Cody.
No, I do think that I remember in science that I was supposed to take a blood sample and type it at one point. I don't know if I ever pulled it off, but...
I loved when the kid threw the frog.
Yes.
Oh, God.
The frog jumping in the jar was a nice little visual thing, too, I thought.
I like the super obvious nod that his dad gives the cops and, like, their exchange where it's like, yeah, something is clearly going on here. Like, really?
Everything's fine now.
Yeah. Wink, wink.
They nod their heads in unison.
Yeah.
Now I'm just going to want to watch this movie again the more we talk about it. I don't know.
Well, I do have a... Robert Reinecke, Godless Man of Science for this one.
Okay.
Which I don't believe we have theme music yet for. But, okay, so when he goes to the base and he's talking to the general, he says something to the effect of, like, it's not being picked up on radar because it absorbs energy. Now, I'm not a godless scientist, but I'm pretty sure that's not how radar works. I believe it's you send out like a ping. And,
that's sonar.
Okay. So how does radar work?
Radar does send out energy and reads back to reflections.
Okay. So
like radio waves or something along those lines, yes.
Validate. Well, this is why I'm not a godless man of science, because I confuse radar and sonar. But so theoretically, I could mask my movements radar-wise by absorbing energy.
That is true.
Okay. Have you ever done that, Robert?
I have not pulled that trick off yet. Yet.
little disappointed, but okay. Thank you, Robert.
I guess the only question I had was, especially watching it now, is like, why Why did Louise Fletcher get eaten up by one of the Martians? Because wasn't she an ally with
them?
Yeah,
that's what I thought, too. And then they started laughing. Oh, man, that was funny.
Yeah. It's like, okay, well, I guess they don't like her, so they're going to eat her. And I mean, I know he hits her with the bag of pennies, and she sort of just, like, tumbles into one of them, and they're all, like, laughing as she's getting eaten. But even when I was younger, I was like, huh, I guess they just wanted to get rid of her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Apparently in the novelization, the actual end scene, which we don't see, was Lorraine Newman feeding Timothy Bottoms to one of those aliens in the bedroom.
Oh, so that's what's happening when David is... Oh. I always wondered about that, too.
Yeah, like, so apparently that was a setup for the end scene.
Wait a minute, why don't I own the novelization? Going on eBay now. These are things I need to know eventually if I ever do a commentary for this one.
Invader from Mars, minute by minute.
Hey, I'll do it. I'm down. I'm a weirdo.
So anything else you want to bring up, Jim?
I was curious how you guys like this one compared to other Tobey Hooper films.
Well, it's definitely not as good as Poltergeist. That's for sure.
Yeah, it's definitely not as good as Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
No. I actually rewatched Salem's Lot this summer. And
so did I.
Oh, I need to see that again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that a lot. I would say I like that more than this, but it's actually like it's kind of the same thing that I like about Stephen King is I like just how he constructs a town and all the relationships and interconnecting webs. Like the horror stuff itself, I think is the stuff that I don't enjoy about Stephen King, and that's the stuff that I think actually Tobey Hooper does bring to the miniseries, but I think he also nails like a lot of the small town stuff pretty well too, and that's the stuff I like in this. I just don't like the horror in this.
I will say it's been forever since I seen Salem's Lot, and I didn't see it first run, but I can distinctly remember the kids that did see Salem's Lot when it played as a miniseries raving about the floating kids sequence on the bus the day after it aired.
Yeah, like that and like the first appearance of Kurt Barlow, I think are still pretty terrifying.
But yeah, I mean, I don't know if I've seen enough Tobey Hooper to truly rank him, but I mean, I do like Life Force, and I Texas Chainsaw Massacre is an acclaimed classic for a reason, and Poltergeist I like, and Spielberg might have been a hands-on producer, but I still feel that it's a Tobey Hooper film.
I like The Funhouse. I think it's...
Oh, I love The Funhouse. Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, that's good. That's really good.
Yeah, that one is good. That one's super creepy.
Yeah.
Been a long time since I've seen that one, but yeah.
But once you get to, like, 1990, it gets a little dicey once you start with spontaneous combustion and you sort of go forward from there.
I don't think I've seen anything of his since.
Yeah, I don't think I have either.
Yeah, I don't know. There's like this crazy cult following behind the Mangler that I kind of don't get.
That's what, the crocodile?
No, that's the
there's one
dry cleaner press.
And there's Eaten Alive.
Eaten Alive, right, Eaten Alive. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's good. That's pretty good.
Yeah, honestly, I don't really like the short story of the Mangler, so.
Yeah. Pretty weak.
Mangler versus Tingler, Robert. Let's get the hot take.
Oh, no.
I haven't seen the Tingler yet.
Okay.
Ooh.
Well,
I'm going to correct
Let's try Vincent Price saying the Mangler. You, the Mingler. Now, Vincent Price saying the Tingler. You, the Tingler. I think Tingler wins.
I think Tingler wins, too. I kind of surprised that nobody's revisited Invaders from Mars again. I don't think you could do it as a movie these days and people would show up, but I would think that with the success Stranger Things.
I sure.
You could do a miniseries on Netflix or somebody based on the material.
Have they referenced Invaders from Mars on Stranger Things?
They're not up to 1986 yet.
Okay. Like
they might jump past it the way the kids are aging.
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, they better get on that pretty damn quick then. But yeah, so much great stuff in 86. You got Little Shop of Horrors. You have
Aliens. Well, aliens. They've already kind of done Aliens, but yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, there's certainly lots you could do with that. I would think that somebody could do something along the lines with it, maybe updated or not. Maybe you can set it in the 50s again and just get a little bit better kid actors in it.
Yeah, why not? I'd be down for that.
Mm-hmm. Maybe add a teacher character and maybe flesh out the kids a little bit, and there you go.
What's our recasting for this? Is it like Tilda Swinton as as McKeach?
Yeah, she was in the Suspiria remake.
Yeah,
I could see that working.
Or Stacy Keach as Keach.
Ooh, who would play the dad? Michael Shannon.
I don't know if Michael Shannon can play like a loving dad.
I could see Kristen Wiig as McCouch.
What's that?
I can see Kristen Wiig as McCouch.
I can see that. Or Karen Black.
Yeah.
The nurse.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think you could do it as a... I mean, there's a bunch of ways you could go with it, depending on how serious you want it to be.
Yeah. I'm down.
Is it Lorraine Newman's daughter... an actress now?
Oh, that's right, yeah. I've heard she's in some things, and she's really good.
With Gene Smart?
I gotta look that up. Yeah, Hex, that's right, you're right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I feel that you could do something with it.
Yeah, why not? I'm actually itching for new Body Snatchers, to be honest. You know, the era of Trump, I'm like, come on.
But like orange ones?
Yeah.
There's gotta be a horse dewormer joke in there.
Oh, God, no.
Oh, God.
Please.
And of course, Hunter Carson will have to do a cameo in the new Invaders from Mars.
So did you guys like Karen Black in this? I thought she was actually pretty good.
I just didn't like her screaming.
Oh, I love the screaming. Okay.
I thought it was a silly scream.
Yeah, she's crazy.
Karen Black is kind of, I think, underrated. I think I always like her when she shows up.
Yeah, I do too. I think she's really good.
Trilogy of Terror, of course. Is where, a triple dose of her. I think quadruple dose of her.
Yeah, no, you're right about 1986, because you got The Fly, Night of the Creeps, Aliens, Critters... From Beyond. Wow.
Whoa, Texas Chainsaw From Beyond.
2. Whew. This is a good year for horror. Could do a whole podcast on 1986 horror movies.
Yeah, some kind of Phantasm in there, too.
I wouldn't be surprised if there was a sequel.
Sorry, my cat is going crazy.
I think they probably were that period in between, but... maybe
Psycho 3. No Phantasm sequel.
So you got Top Gun.
Oh, yeah.
Back to school.
Close enough.
That is terrifying, yeah.
Crocodile Dundee, Platoon.
Crocodile Dundee is definitely a horror movie.
Hey. Iron Eagle. Oh, man.
Oh, wow.
All right, now it's just going to be reading from Wikipedia, so I'll...
Who can forget Vamp? I know Jay Cheel's a fan.
Actually, 8 Million Ways to Die, I did see that for the first time. That is pretty badass.
I do like Vamp as well. I like I like how they incorporate archery.
Oh, yeah.
In the end.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, that has its moments.
Mm-hmm.
Is that Ferris Bueller 86?
Yep. Big Trouble in Little
China. Oh, nice.
86, pretty good year.
Coming in from behind there. She's got a habit. Flight of the Navigator.
That's being remade.
Blue Velvet. We forgot about Blue Velvet.
Of course. I forgot who's remaking Flight of the Navigator. Oh, it's Bryce Dallas Howard. She's remaking Flight of the Navigator.
So that's a Disney Plus one, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, I'll watch it. I'm curious. You know, I'm a kid of the 80s, so if you're going to bring it back, I'll see what's going on.
Okay, well, I don't really have much more on Invaders from Mars. So I think that kind of wraps it up. So thank you, Jim. It's been a fun episode.
Oh, of course. I knew it would be.
Mm-hmm.
I just wish the Scream Factory Blu-ray wasn't out of print.
Yeah, really, that was disappointing. And I wish there was a good print available on home video for the original, too.
That's it. I'm super relieved that both of these are on YouTube.
Yeah. I mean, we didn't have to look too hard for them, I guess, ultimately, but...
yeah.
Oh, Chopping Mall is 1986.
You got American Tail, Sid and Nancy, 52 Pickup.
Yeah, just turn this into a 1986 podcast.
Yeah, Call of the Money, Children of the Lesser God.
Critters.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyhow. Nat, it's your pick for next month.
It is. So I potentially may have a guest lined up for this one.
Ooh.
An expert on this particular film.
And oh, is it your son?
No.
Oh,
no.
Dang it.
I'd be interested to get his hot take. He actually can sit still for long enough to watch a movie, but my daughter cannot. But this is not an 86 movie. This is, however, an 85 movie.
Ooh.
And it is the comic masterpiece Real Genius.
Ooh.
Wow!
Val Kilmer.
Yeah. Which I have not seen in quite a while, so I'm looking forward to it.
Everybody,
I remember really liking it, but it's been a while.
Yeah. Well, you get the triumphant return of William Atherton playing essentially the same character as from Ghostbusters. And Bunchville you'll probably never see again.
Like Peter Tarokvi?
Yep.
Yeah.
Mark Kamiyama. And,
Vilmos Zsigmond shot it.
Ooh.
The cinematographer for McCabe and Mrs. Miller.
Yeah.
Oh!
And Close Encounters of the Third Kind and a bunch of other stuff that all looks great.
Have you ever seen this movie, Cody?
No, I never even heard of it.
Oh, okay.
Wow.
Have you ever seen any of the Val Kilmer 80s comedies, which would be essentially this and Top Secret?
No. Is this one... Are they good, or...?
I like them.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have nothing but good things to say about Top Secret.
Is it like Armed and Dangerous movie? With John Candy and Eugene Levy?
What's that?
Is it like Armed and Dangerous with John Candy and Eugene Levy?
No.
I've not actually seen Armed and Dangerous, but this one's kind of like a little bit more highbrow version of Revenge of the Nerds. Like a cooler version of that, I guess.
Yeah. I would say that would kind of a graduate school, and it kind of balances the humor, but with some realism. We'll get into it when we see it, but yeah, I have fond memories of it. We'll see if my memories lie, but I had fond memories of it.
I had a little crush on the love interest Jordan in the film, Michelle Mayrink.
Michelle Mayrink?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Definitely my type, and it's fun. I think you got is it William Atherton?
It is William Atherton.
Yeah.
You're gonna have fun with this.
Yeah, I was thinking about it the other day, but that And I guess it would qualify because I know there are lasers involved in this film. So.
Oh, yeah. And popcorn.
Yes.
And tears for fears.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Voices from God.
And Laszlo. But, look forward to Real Genius for next month.
And okay. I look forward to December for Secret Santa number, whatever it is.
Wait, six, seven?
I think it's six, but it could be seven.
Wow.
I know. Is that a soundboard, or are you actually saying that, Jim?
Well, for all you Film Junk fans, I don't know. I do have the soundboard. I just never use it. I only used it on the episode that the Film Junk guys appeared on.
Nice.
I should have used Frank clips, though. That would have been funny. Game of the year.
Game.
Karnak's legend.
Oh, we're nerds.
I know. You should do a soundboard, Jim, but like just, you know, like half syllables, like, you know, words that actually aren't complete. So it'd be like the guy. Yeah, exactly. So it's not anyone actually saying anything comprehensible. Just a
it's like that sound that Warren Zevon makes in Werewolves of London at one point. He just goes, duh! His hair was perfect.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Have fun.
Yeah.
Thanks for having me.
Yes. So thank you, Jim. Woo-hoo. And that should wrap up this episode. If you have questions or comments, you can email us at skiespodcast@gmail.com. Post on this topic at wherethelongtailends.com or leave us a note on Facebook. Also, feel free to share a link on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for listening, and we hope you'll join us next month for Real Genius. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
It was during a thunderstorm. David wasn't asleep no more. Little green man just fell to earth. And his daddy is now so disturbed. And the whole town is acting strange. Hungry for frogs and deranged. Thank God the school nurse is here. The army is so full of fear. Armed with copper and lots of screams. This has all got to be a dream. General Wilson, what will you do? I know David must focus on saving this entire planet. Oh man, Mr. Potato Head creeps. Controlled by this dick brain monstrosity. Take a look at my pennies and such a silly butt court. You dork, these creatures are not your pets. I'm sure that you must have guessed that they're invaders from
Watch the skies, everywhere. Keep looking. Keep watching the skies.